Hello and welcome to our pre-lesson for Area Under the Curve. I did leave you all these notes. They're kind of long and in detail about Area Under the Curve and why we can use definite integrals. These notes, this theorem, these proofs, they're not part of your final exams. You're not required to know all of this theory for the final exam, but I think it's important to go through it. Like I said, I'm not going to go through every point in your notes because we have several pages, but I'll leave that to you to go through it and look through it carefully. But I just feel it's important to go through this pre-lesson to realize when we do our actual lesson about area under the curve or between two curves, why we can use definite integrals and just the whole point of that lesson. So a pre-lesson. But if this pre-lesson and then the other videos I'm leaving you to watch plus my lesson should all kind of fill in the full picture about area under a curve and between two curves. Okay, so our pre-lesson is the area problem. So when we're asked for the area of something, sometimes it's easy. So if they ask us, like in example one, what's the area of a rectangle? Easy, we have a formula for that. The area of a rectangle is length times width. So if we know the dimensions, put those values in, multiply together. Super easy to get area of a rectangle. What if our shape is now a triangle? That's pretty easy too, because we have a formula for that as well. The area of a triangle is 1/2 times base times height. So if we're given the dimensions, you put it into the formula and solve. Really easy. Okay, now here comes today's lesson. What if we want the area under the curve? Well, that's a little bit different if you're doing area under the curve or between two curves, because it's not a definite shape like a rectangle or triangle. We have no formula where we just put the numbers in and solve. So it's a little bit trickier. So how do we solve a problem? So for this example, we have a curve and that straight line there. And we want to know what's the area under the curve between 0 and 1. So if I could shade it in, it's that piece underneath. Well, we don't have a formula, so how do we do that? So I'm just going to quickly go through all the notes about different ways we can get that area under a curve. So because we don't have an actual formula, we're going to have to find some methods to estimate it. So one way to estimate the area under the curve is to use rectangles. So you can see we can do rectangles underneath, and this is the area where under the curve in our example. And I did say in the example it has to be between 0 and 1. Okay, but you can see that those aren't full rectangles, right? So we have the area under the curve. It's partial rectangles. So if we're using the rectangular method, we're going to have to do some estimation. So one way is if you drew the full rectangle, we would just use the right end point. So you use the right point to estimate it. And why would we do that? Because the shape we're looking for isn't a rectangle, it's an area under the curve. But since we don't have a formula for that, you know what we do in math. We take something that we know how to work with and transfer that information over to what we want. So we do know how to find areas of rectangles that I just told you. So following along, we've got each rectangle has a width of 1/4 because we divided 4 rectangles evenly between 0 and 1. That was the interval given. And the height is y equals x squared. So to get the area of each rectangle, that was our first slide. Rectangles, the area is width times height. So again, I just filled this in doing width times height, filling it in for the 4 rectangles. If I did that, I would get a value of 0.46875. So that's the area using that method. But I'm sure you see there's a flaw in that method because I've overestimated, right? Look at this little piece. There's a lot of pieces above the curve and we just want the area under the curve. So that area of 0.46875, it's an approximation, but we know we've over approximated. The actual area is less because look at all these extra pieces above. So that gave me an estimation of it, and I know that the real area would be less than that because we've overestimated by using the right hand point. Okay, let's try another method. Let's do the same thing, but let's use the left hand point of each rectangle. So again, oh, it's a little bit small on my slide, but I think you have a better copy in your notes. So again, it's the same idea, still from 0 to 1. We're still putting 4 rectangles in that same spot, but now we're going to talk about the left hand point instead of the right hand. So again, it's the same method, rectangles are width times height, same idea, but now we get a value of 0.21875. Again, what's the problem with that approximation? For this one, now we are underestimating. When you use this method, now we've got missing pieces under the curve. So if you use the right-hand point, you've overestimated. If you use the left-hand point, you're underestimating. So what's the real area? Well, we know it's somewhere in between the two, right? So the real area, L is for left, R is for right. So the real area, using the left side, you underestimate. Using the right, you overestimate. So the real area is somewhere in between the two. So that's the method that we use. Now, that's if we divided that space underneath into four rectangles. But what if we divide it into 8, 10, 30, 50, 1,000? You can see the more rectangles we use, the closer we're gonna get to the actual area. When we just use four rectangles, our area was somewhere between 0.21875 and 0.46875. But look, if we the more rectangles we use, look at the closer and closer these numbers come. If we used 1,000, it's between 0.33285 and 0.33383. So you get the idea. To get a better approximation, the more rectangles you use, the better you'll be, or closer you'll be to the actual area. Okay, and then that's a diagram. And again, this is all directly from your textbook, so you can read through this fully, but I just wanna explain what all these notes mean, because it's a little bit overwhelming seeing all these diagrams and formulas. Okay, so hopefully that part makes sense. Then if we keep going with this, the example says show that the sum of the areas of the upper approximating rectangles approaches 1/3. Or that's a fancy way of saying show that the limit of n approaching infinity for the right side is equal to 1/3. And again, I'm not going to go through all this. There's the formula again, right? We do length times or width times height. And I think if we fill it in, the width is 1 over n, the height is x squared. So it's just 1n times 1n squared. 1n times 2 over n squared, and so on. So again, I'll leave that work for you to go through, because it shouldn't be that bad. If we take our knowledge of limits and apply it, we do get that the limit is 1/3. And if we did the same thing and did the limit from the left-hand side, we'd also get 1/3. So that's a lot of information. We'll let you read through those steps. Okay, now if we keep going on the next page, I've left you with some definitions. So the definition then is that to get the area of a region S that lies under the graph of a continuous function, F is the limit of the sum of the areas of the approximating rectangle. So that's what I just showed you, right? We can use the right-hand side, left-hand side, but that's what we do in calculus. If we want to get the area under or between curves, what we do is we just divide that area up into a whole bunch of rectangles and we add up the sum. So that's all that that's saying. That looks a little complicated, but that's what we're saying, and that's what we've done in the previous slides. And then sigma notation used to be in the curriculum guide in high school. They did take it off when they changed the curriculum a few years ago, so you no longer encounter sigma notation in high school. But sigma notation, Greek letter, S, right? Sigma just says the same thing. You're just adding the terms together. So what does this all mean, and how does this connect to definite integrals? Well, there's something called a Riemann sum, and I did leave you a video to watch about a Riemann sum. It kind of just, basically what we talked about, the approximating triangles, kind of leads us up to the Riemann sum. So again, it's exactly what we talked about. If you divide an interval into subintervals, and we've got that width, and then you let that be the endpoints of the subintervals, and then you've got your sample points, then you've got the definite integral from A to B, is the limit of that sum. So again, this is kind of a long, fancy definition, but that's exactly what we just did. You take that area, you subdivide it into equal widths, and then you get the sum of the rectangles, and then you add that up together to get the total area. What does any of this have to do with our topic? That's a lot of information. So what's the point? The point of all this is to find the area under a curve, we use definite integrals. And that's why the integral sign, remember I mentioned a few lessons ago, it came from the letter to represent the word, it's the letter S, it's a stretched out S for the word sum. Now you see how integrals are connected to sum. So when we use definite integrals, we are just getting the sum of all these other pieces underneath or between the curves. So that's your pre-lesson. I'm going to leave you a couple videos to watch that fill in some information about Riemann sum and just a little bit more information about area under between curves. And then when you get to the actual lesson, area under or between curves, that's super easy. We kind of assume that you understand all that. But from now on, you don't need to prove or know any of this theories or formulas. You just need to know that to get the area under between curves, we use definite integrals. Okay, I hope that helped. Good luck.